it's quite a painless interview.
I hope so.
Andrew Pereira. Hi. Andrew Pereira, man of many roles. I know you first as a hardware techie.
Yeah.
Supporting computers very efficiently.
Yeah.
Then I know you as a journalist.
Yeah.
Then I know you as a guy keeping track and taking part in seminars on how to trace your roots.
Yes.
One of which we pushed you into.
Yes.
And then I know you as a YouTuber making interesting films, very well crafted films, unlike mine. So if anything goes wrong here, I am to blame, not you.
No, with a lot of help from friends.
Okay, yeah, okay. Yeah. Tell us about your interest in local issues.
Interest in local issues.
Why is it important? Why do you do it?
When you say local issues, could you be specific, like what kind of local
understanding
issues?
Goa. Which I see you do a lot of. You have a deep interest in it. You have a deep interest in history.
Yeah. I think Goa is a very fascinating place. The history that we've gone through over the last so many hundred years, I'm not talking about just Portuguese, but maybe even pre-Portuguese, is so fascinating that you probably will not get this in any other part of India.
Not in such a small compact area.
Not in such a small compact area. And the layers are fascinating. You know, as you uncover layer after layer, you find stuff which is sometimes mind-blowing.
And yet people don't bother with it too much, no? Yeah.
No. Goa, in fact, has some kind of an international connect, you know. Somehow we've been connected to the world through ages.
Lots.
Even if you go back to the first century, Goa was connected to Rome. You'll find Roman coins in wells over here and, you know, something from Phoenician boats. And it's very fascinating.
To come down to one specific point, tell us about your video on the 1918... quote-unquote Spanish flu.
Yeah, I was in Raya actually over there, and I saw this pillar, and when I went over there I saw something written in Portuguese, and it was written over there in memories of the victims of the flu of 1918, and I was like, and it was like a full-on structure, it was totally abandoned. And
which year?
This I went in 2019, I think, or 20. It was in 20.
Before the pandemic?
During the pandemic, during the early pandemic. Stages of the pandemic. And I researched, and I also talked to Albert Govea, who is my neighbor from my village. He's a retired NIO scientist. And he showed me some fascinating figures from Sukkot Church, wherein the numbers in 1918 had just jumped up. Deaths had just jumped up for nobody knows what reason then. We didn't even think about the Spanish flu.
I see.
So I went to the Raya Church with some friends. I got some help. And as we looked at five-year records through that, we just saw 1918 was double than all the other years. And then that added to the monument outside the church, unexplained monument in memory of the victims of the flu of 1918. And then you put two things together, and then you get a great story that you support this monument with records from the church.
That was a very well-made documentary. What's your username on YouTube?
Andrew Pereira. Just
Andrew Pereira.
Yeah, just my name. Yeah.
What nomad, you said something? Digital something? No, just Andrew Pereira.
Just Andrew Pereira, yeah. Okay. So it's a concept which I'm looking at called the Lost Stories of Goa.
Okay.
And I'm looking at something which is very tough to find, something that people don't know. And I take my time with research. It takes a lot of time.
Yeah.
Yes, I get a lot of help from friends too, who help me out. We are all passionate about this. So we hope to find some interesting things about Goa and then tell the story.
What was the challenge for moving from technology to journalism? You liked it.
I love journalism. Journalism was a calling, a vocation. I just, within 2 weeks of being in journalism, I knew like this is what I was always looking for. Yeah.
For the rest of your life in different forms, in whatever form.
Different forms. And now we have to evolve. You know, we went to print media earlier, but now things have changed so fast. You have to move into different forms of storytelling. So,
yeah. Which is not a bad thing in that sense.
It's not a bad thing. No.
It gives you a wider reach, and you know.
Yeah, yeah.
Monetizing it might be a bit of a challenge, but.
Yeah, but we are not looking at monetizing right now. It's all about telling the story.
Yeah.
It's all about telling the story.
What would you give a word of advice to youngsters wanting to study Goa? Where to start? How to keep it up? How to sustain?
I would say start first with your own family.
Your backyard.
Yeah, start with your backyard. If your grandparents are alive, talk to them. I wish my grandparents were alive today. I would have got so much information from them. But I
realize that a bit late.
You realize that later in life, yeah. So I talk to a lot of old people. I sit with older generation people, and I record their history, oral histories. A lot of what they tell me is not written in the history books. History is very subjective. It's always written by
The big shots, with
a bias.
The winners.
By the winners. You know, whatever. But you won't really get a correct picture of what really happened. And talking,
there are thousands of histories.
Thousands of histories, alternative histories. Yeah. And when you talk to some of these old people, you come to know what really happened in this village at a local level. I'm not interested in world history and world wars and all. There is a reason why the cross is built in your own vado. There is a reason behind it. Hmm. It could be the Spanish flu, which everybody has forgotten now. And, you know, hundreds of people died in your own vado due to the Spanish flu. And that is why the cross is there in the corner. This one example. But there's a story behind every corner. And it's really fascinating. And it's only when you talk to the old people, that's when you get this information of what really happened. Like, I found a rock carving in Sukkur. And then talking to old people, that's how I'm trying to piece together the story of why this rock carving is there. What is the story in this rock carving? You know, there's a koito, a chopper. There are 12 crosses etched on it. Yeah. So it's something which I'm continuing.
Andrew, last question. That paper you presented, the talk you presented during that seminar on finding your roots.
Yeah.
In brief?
Genealogy.
Yeah.
Yeah, actually, you only had asked me to give the talk for that and I wasn't kind of prepared. But yeah, I
got... It was interesting.
Yeah, thank you. I got a lot of help for that too. I asked several people to help me out. And it was about, again, trying to trace your roots. And there are different ways of tracing your roots. The first way is try and get your Portuguese theors. The Portuguese theors are like a historical document of the person.
What's it? Identity? No.
Theor. The theor is your birth certificate.
Okay.
See, in Indian birth certificate, you'll just write your name, father and mother. But if you want to really dig your family history, for example, if your parents are born in Portuguese time or grandparents, get the theor.
From?
From the archives.
Archives.
Get it from the archives. And on that one theor, you'll get the person's name, you'll get the person's parents, where the person's parents are from, what they did. Then you'll get your grandparents on both the sides, mother side and father side. Where are they from? What they did? You'll get five witness names there also. You'll get over there. You'll get maybe even the godparents' names over there. You know, I mean, you get so much of information on one document where you can go back three generations. So if I find, say, my father's theor, I can find out my grandfather's name, which is something which is not available in the Indian system of records. This is something which is a gift given to us, I believe. The system of recording that was given to us by the Portuguese is a gift. I wish we could continue it. I wish we could continue the same system because we are going to keep information for generations that way. Not the current system what we are following. It's superb. I mean, so theor is one way. Baptism certificates are another way. Kumindads are another way. For Hindus, temple like Mazania records are another way. Property documents like inventories, partition deeds, from the Portuguese are very, very good for information if you want to trace your family tree.
Thank you so much, and it's really impressive. Andrew Pereira, age?
That's okay. 39.
Yeah. Eligible bachelor.
Yeah.
Thank you, and sorry I couldn't help but embarrassing you. Thank you so much, and keep up the good work you do, Andrew. It's so important for young people to do this work, and I think not many young people do it. We are sitting outside the Saligaon Institute on a market day, and there's music going on in the background, and some vendors sitting out there, and we are just sitting at the at the side of the badminton court. And sorry for dragging you into this without when you least expected it. Really appreciate.
I'm not used to taking questions as a journalist.
I know.
Other side of the camera now.
I know. Being on that side is quite scary, which is why I don't give interviews.
Yeah, you said it would be painless. So thank you.
Thanks.